2016 to 2023, you can rig out with a tent and you can take it down roads and trails that you never would have taken in 2016. And so you watch TV and, you know, Super Bowl or whatever it is, the commercials or car commercials, first thing they do is within a minute, not even a minute, 15 seconds, they're pulling off into a trail in their car. And so they're already planting the seed to people in this room that you can go out in the woods in our car. And they're not doing it for me. They're doing it to sell more cars. But it just so happens we have products that fit with what they're building. And every manufacturer is building something that's competitive in the four-wheel drive, overlanding, off-road market.
They just want to sell the car and push it elsewhere. So that's where we're going to be coming with our partnerships. And, you know, between the four of us, we've got a lot of people in that industry. So I'm looking forward to getting into that. Again, we're a month and a half into this place, so it's on the list as
ground
far as
floor,
ground floor. We're going to hire an outside salesperson, and that's definitely going to be a big part of it. And as he mentioned with commercials, Chevrolet right now, they have a commercial of their trucks. The very first truck they show is towing an overlanding trailer. The second truck they show has a rig with a rack and a tent on the back of the truck. So even Mazda, you talked about a small car. Mazda is advertising now for overlanding and towing an overlanding trailer. These trailers weigh 1,000 pounds. You pull it behind a Subaru or a Mazda, no problem. So it's certainly, they're doing it for us as far as educating the market. But what you're going to start seeing, especially all of you being here now, you're going to start seeing these things on rooftops and go, that's what that was. And you're really going to see it commercials. And so while we don't have to educate, we're trying to educate, but the dealers and the popularity of it is going to educate everyone for us. Another part of it's not really educating, but we're hosting, just the other night, they did a Land Rover Range Rover rally. And so that was on Tuesday night during the freeze. Y'all remember the freeze? It wasn't that long ago. Tuesday night, over 30 Land Rovers came on a bad, terrible night. That shows you how happy they are to not only see what we've got here, but just to get out with their club. And so not only Land Rovers, but Jeep clubs, Toyota clubs, there's 4Runner clubs, there's Taco clubs, which is Toyota Tacoma, Rotundas, they call them tacos in the industry, even Subaru clubs, and there's so many different ones. So we're going to use that for our marketing, and we're going to be hosting them. Just this on the 18th, we're going to do Broncos and barbecues. So I'm gonna grill up a bunch of barbecue. We're gonna have 4 Broncos out here and just have everybody come out, check it out. And that's how the word is gonna spread. I think it's gonna
spread. We have an expert barbecuer on our.
Really?
Well, we got one.
Yeah. I heard
challenge accepted.
San Antonio Rodeo, so.
That's
yes.
Well, we didn't win any meets this year, but we did get first place Bloody Mary, so.
Yeah. I have pictures.
Yeah, he's got pictures.
The blurry?
He took pictures before.
I wouldn't be here if they were blurry.
Truth be told, there's these groups on social media. It's a private group, and they come to the group, and all we do is reach out to the group admin and say, hey, we're looking at hosting.
Well, they're approaching us.
They're very selective, which is good. No, we're going to take care of them. Everybody would love to invite every group to everything, but you know, you can't possibly please everybody. So we feel really fortunate that two or three of the big ones are embracing what we're doing. Yeah. Yeah, re-advertise.
Josh and Brad, I failed to introduce you guys.
I was going
to
roll with that. I got one more tip we've got. One more. So, Brian, as you know, had the RV store. And his non-compete in the RV world is ending this fall. And yes, we're very excited about that. We've got the opportunity.
I wasn't sure that was going to be
public. We've got the opportunity, and not only the contacts through Brian here, to really be a player right away in that industry. But what we love a lot of is Sprinter vans and Class Bs. The Sprinter vans are just rocket ship popularity right now. And
with that, I'm going to pass you over to Brad, who knows a lot about that.
I'm Brad. My background is in the automotive sales. I've been buying and selling vehicles since I was 16 years old, specializing in the off-road stuff and then also the sleep-in vans, whether they were conversion vans, kind of the old Roadmaster vans. And we know that that market is popular. Hashtag van life is what they call it. I'm sure everyone's seen the Instagrammers. They're all in their vans. But we want to be able to have it where it kind of leaves a little bit of the RV world and gets more into the adventure world, where you truly have the right gear, the right equipment inside to go out somewhere remote and sleep comfortably, use a restroom, shower comfortably, but get out of the vehicle and utilize the awnings
and
stuff.
And park in your driveway.
Park in your driveway and have a vehicle that you don't have to tow a giant monster trailer, because you're only going to be able to go to trailer park. That's fine. So we're going to have a very, we're going to identify the small teardrop trailers, travel trailers, and
the other thing that Brad is a an expert on and learning more and more every day is on the tent side of it. And so we've really, it could have taken us 5 years to figure out the tent side of it. And I think we figured it out almost, we're probably about 90% along in less than a year. And we've made some really good contacts. And give you an example of the tent side of it is, was it last Tuesday that Peru came?
Yes.
So last Tuesday, James Peru, the worldwide sales manager, came here.
He's one of the partners of the company.
When I was in Portugal a few months ago, they wanted me to come see them, but my dates were, I don't know who's been to Europe in this room, but in, you know, during Christmas holidays, they don't work, okay? And I think August is like that too. And so I was there during that holiday time, and even if it's the most important meeting in the world, you're out, okay? You're not going to be seeing anybody, but they really want us to visit their factory. They're very excited about this brand new dealer. You know that, you know, really doesn't. We haven't sold that many. We sold, I don't know, 20 or something. But they see the potential. It's exciting. We found them through Brad.
Yeah, the really interesting thing we brought up is the trading aspect of how if someone has a brand that we don't carry that we can buy, tint off their car and sell them ours. I don't know another product in the automotive industry or the sporting goods that has such high residual value that extends to. A tent that we sell brand new for $4,000 can bring as much as $3,800 on the open market. That's after someone camped in it for 2 years, and the amount of demand is high. So that product is really appealing to us, the value it holds. And then the amount of attention and pre-owned stuff it gets. Talking about the tents, it's really interesting. I would say 95% of all the tents on the market are made in the same factory in China. And we've been able to identify companies that are not made in that factory for quality issues, material issues, odor issues. But we've had a lot of tents that started to last a problem. So we identified that very early on. The people we partnered with now are very confident and very certain. Tears, zippers,
if the market takes the dip, if the discretionary spending is gone, if you're not buying new vehicles, which that's another number we can put out, is 42% of all new trucks coming out, they get something added on, an upfit in the first year. 70% of Jeeps do the same thing. But if the new cars kind of slow down, interest rates are going to slow down some of the buying. They've got their existing car, and they want to feel like they love that existing car again. And the best way to do so is bring it here in the service department and upfit it and just add something to it. So I think our backup plan for that is right here. However, what we've noticed when the economy pulls back and when we have an extreme COVID issue, it tends to help this industry for whatever reason. It hasn't slowed down. They may not have extra income
but it's not on layaway, but they're literally in their mind, they're putting stuff on layaway. I'm coming back, I've got customers coming back in April, I'll be able to afford that one in April, and they just spent $2,000 with us here. And they're just gonna keep adding as they got it. But I think that we are gonna see a change. I'm preparing for the change. I'm watching the market, which is confusing as can be every day, as you know.
Yeah.
But I think the upfitting of existing vehicles, which we're really starting to try to focus on, is going to help sustain through any other pullback or loss of income from discretion.
Well, I think that's another interesting thing that you've done is you grew on the cash flow.
Yeah.
You kind of organically
grew it. We organically grew it. So, being that we were growing it organically and it wasn't, you know, a roll-up and an acquisition situation, we rarely get pressures related to that. So like, for example, Hawks, we have plans to grow the company. So in a contracted economy, in my view, it's a good time to do that, because as we're opening new stores and we're looking to order more product, there's factories that have product that they can't unload because they have either either canceling POs or they're going out of business. And so James has had, he bought three of those bicycles at 10% off this week, more than 10% more than we were getting before, which a month and a half ago, they never would have done that. And it's a lot of money, you know. We have some tent manufacturers, and you had a meeting with Brood. I wasn't able to be here. And they have a crunch right now. They have inventory that was built to be shipped to certain dealers in America that have canceled their POs. And so it is contracting, and it is hurting people. But for someone that's small and growing, and you know, we're going to do it in the increments that we can, I think we get better buys during that time.
We have stuff in that Connex right out there. We've got James Burrius in here that we have the stock that he doesn't even have in Florida that he's got dealers that are looking for. And so we can rotate out inventory, and he can send it to us, and we can send it out. And so we're looking at being a possible mid-center of the country
distributor
for James Burrius. So we're in the early phases of that as well.
Yeah.
And yes, we have a conflict of interest because we're selling multiple other brands, but we would, if we had to, you know, kind of build a shell to be able to just be a distributor for James Burrius on this side, that seed has been planted. So.
And to answer your question too about, I think, the demographics, you were wondering about that, is it's a pretty solid demographic. It's typically, if I had to like grab a, you know, just a person that's educated, it's typically mid-30s to late 40s. They're working, most of that, probably half married, half single, right?
You're staring at all of them, right?
Yeah.
I know we have all our customers here.
And they have a passion for traveling, and they have a passion for the outdoors. And whatever that is, it could be running, it could be hiking, it could be fishing, it could be kayaking, it could be surfing. All those things fall under our umbrella. And so it's a very durable demographic. And the price to entry is pretty low. It's not like if you wanted a Prevo motorhome, that's your dream to have one, but it's $2 million. You know, it's just not feasible. You know, and maybe you could probably afford it, but it just doesn't make sense. It doesn't make sense, and especially if the economy is rocky, you don't go, okay, I'm gonna go spend $2 million. But if you see that you get totally rigged out, be on the road, live out in the woods for, you know, 2 months, and we can do it for $44,000, and you're all in. That's kind of attractive, and you can also park all the equipment in your garage, so you don't have to have a storage facility if you're paying another fee to. So the first part is the demographics. It's pretty specific. It's a pretty solid specific demographic. The DIYers are all over the map, and it could be the guy that is, you know, living on a welfare check that can weld, and he can build him his own rig. But that's not that's not our customer. You know, so it's pretty solid.
Do you offer financing?
Yeah.
On big ticket, right here, our trailers and bigger purchases we can. Are there insurance implications to the customer if they're on one of these on their car?
Yeah, it's similar as a high factor accessory that you have on your vehicle.
Yeah, because bolt on is part of the vehicle.
Same with the trailers. The trailers are always usually covered on your insurance.
And we depend on the manufacturers, and they're all pretty solid. You know, we don't have any small manufacturers that are sketchy. They're going to help a roof rack put on properly, and it blows off and kills the family behind the car. Prinzu Roof Racks is a multi-billion-dollar company, and they're going to take care of that. The key is that we, as a dealer, we follow their instructions to the team. We don't just put something on because it's quicker our way. So we're really intent on doing it the right way.
I don't know if any of you know what Dometic is, but if you've ever had an RV, chances are you've had Dometic products, because Dometic's been around in the RV world for many, many, many years. All your refrigerators, toilets, sinks, it's Dometic.
And they used to own Electrolux, if you ever heard of that, the old vacuum cleaner.
So yeah. Dometic actually now owns Ignik. So they just bought Ignik coolers. They also own Firmwater, which is that tent right there and that display on the inside. But that's just the cooler side. Dometic is one of the products. And then in the back of the Jeep, I've got a refrigerator Dometic with waters in there if anybody's getting thirsty. That is a refrigerator. But Rome is one of the names in overlanding we wanted to be a part of. And we want to be an overlanding known store. Yeah, we're camping and outdoors and all that, but overlanding is just, it's a club. It's really tight, and I can't tell you how many people come in here so excited that there's a store just like this for them. And so that's why carrying Rome instead of Yeti has been better, other than the fact I haven't been able to get Yeti. But Yeti's been watching us, apparently, and they've been coming down, and they're huge fans. The last two weekends in a row, their employees have been coming down here buying stuff from us, and they want to be in this world.
From Austin.
Yeah,
one of the VP of
they're driving in from Austin each weekend just to come here.
And they want their C-suite to be invited to the grand opening.
I'm not opposed to Yeti. Yes, they're everywhere. And I had a feeling the reason they turned us down, A, they're everywhere, but they're also popping up their own brick and mortar store. So they may be trying to limit their own competition out there. But that's how we ended up with Rome. Rome is a good partner. We've been to several expos, whether it's the Mountain West Expo or West Expo. There's several big overlanding expos, and I noticed that Rome was a very, very popular part of that, and a lot of foot traffic. And so that immediately tells me who I want to have.
Almost like if you're in the know, you're in the know.
Yeah, pretty much.
You knew right away. I wasn't in the know.
Remember those expos in Las Vegas?
Yeah, what's
the name? No, this the one I went to, the Mountain West is in Loveland, Colorado, just north of Denver, and then Arizona.
We've done
Flagstaff, Arizona. There's probably five really big ones across the country. But they've had a big presence. Dometic had a big presence with Front Runner. There's just a few niche names in this industry that people gravitate to and they know. And so we want to have the product that will bring in our clientele instead of having to work to get them in here and sell them something down here.
So Josh has been building about 2 years now. You're on your third one. Overlanding trailer for personal use. And so he just recently added a tent. So he has the one for the kids and one for the parents.
I had to find a solution to keep the family happy. Bradley
had the first tri-tent. He had an excursion that he had two tents on the roof, and he had a trailer with a tent, and hauled that out.
I like it.
To an event. Marble Falls,
Atlanta.
And that got a lot of attention. big black excursion that's loaded with tents.
So that helicopter started it up.
Yeah. You could get a family of 11 living in there.
So, between that and our 702 horsepower TRX that we just sold with white camouflage, rooftop tent rack, I mean, it was a beast. So between that thing and the TRX, it turned a lot of heads.
Yeah.
We actually met originally at the Hill Country Luxury event, and it was in a huge airplane hangar there in Bernie. And we had Porsches out there racing up and down the strip.
120 miles. I have a video of me in it if you want to learn custom.
Well, we actually set up. We were going to race one of the Porsches in the TRX, but unfortunately, it just didn't happen. Everybody got too busy, and we had to get out and clean up the airstrip so planes could start landing again. But anytime we didn't get enough attention, I'd just go fire up that TRX and throw it up inside the hangar. Every head turned.
You guys had the coolest. You had the coolest.
I'm a little biased, but we did.
We had a good drill day, too, that day.
Yeah.
We're going to, one of the things that we
met me that day.
Met you that day, and here you are.
That's the shining light.
The beacon of the day.
And if we didn't do that, we wouldn't have been meeting all of you.
One of the things that we have identified too, that, you know, overlanding isn't just like it's not like rock crawling. Rock crawling is more of a macho dude thing. You know, you flip the Jeep over, you push it back, and you keep going. And it's a bunch of guys who've got fun in the river bottom. But overlanding, it's either men, women, whatever. It's anybody can do it. Okay. Well, one of the things that Kristen, and y'all didn't meet Kristen yet. Kristen Ramirez, she's
the best.
Corporate office manager. And so we were saying we need more women to come in the store and see this stuff. Because, you know, it's something they can do, but also there's things that they might see as maybe a gift for their husband or boyfriend or a friend. Because, you know, there's things in here you won't see somewhere else. And so when they unwrap it, they're going, oh, wow, where'd you find this? And you know, you wouldn't have bought it at Dillard's or Neiman Marcus or whatever. And so it just almost happened. Since we put that energy out there and started talking about it, we started having this female traffic. It's like, you know, once you just, you know, tell the universe, hey, we need this, the message went out. And so we were really happy about that.
We were upfitting a lady's Jeep the other day. And she's probably one of the coolest Jeeps I've ever seen.
Yeah.
We were
that last
adding
spot?
A bunch of stuff to it. Had a customer come in and you were, oh, wow, that guy's Jeep's really nice. Actually,
you bring it to
that lady's Jeep.
We'll change the name. What, the Hawks Brooks?
We need the last investment we can.
Totally might. Yeah.
So I want to say just one thing before we talk about the Q&A going is, January is our first full month. Our goal was about $125,000 in retail sales, no advertising. Just whatever drives in this driveway, you know, shake their hand, welcome here. We did about $150,000. So we beat our goal. And our GP goal was around $25,000. We did almost $40,000 in GP. Net, you know, I was really surprised at what the net was. The net was close to 37 or something like that, but there's no audit or any input in there, so I don't believe that number right now. but I do believe the top line, and so, you know, it's we're not doing anything except, you know, sitting around wishing we could sell something and doing better than our goal. And our goal was basically just to cover the overhead, have a little bit left over, and we did that. And so I was really happy with that.